Today we are diving into the world of Rust and robotics. Imagine being able to control any machine with the flick of a joystick. In this video, I'll show you how to harness the power of Rust. We will control a DC motor and a servo using nothing more than an Xbox controller and a Raspberry Pi. This video is part of the Embedded Rust playlist. Check it out! So guys, here's the first tip I have for you. Try using VS Code with the SSH plugin. This extension lets you use any remote machine with an SSH server as your development environment. This is extremely powerful because here's what nobody's talking about. As an embedded Rust engineer, your job is to have the most efficient development process possible. And this entails being able to design, build, run, test your code in the fastest, tightest possible loop. Let me just show you what I'm talking about here. So we'll go ahead and connect to the Raspberry Pi, where I already have a folder with a project I created, which is empty. I found this library called Game Input Library for Rust. So here I have the docs next to my code here on the left. So let's see how do we initialize it. Seems like the first thing we need to do is to instantiate the driver. So let me, there you go. So now it's instantiated. I'm pretty sure that the error is not going to match. So just go ahead and unwrap it for now. And now we will go ahead and list all the connected gamepads. So I have to say that this feels very Rust, which is nice. It's compiling. I know that's like the bot joke of every Rust joke from Node people is this. And yeah, it's pretty slow. It's true. So nice. So this proves that we are at least communicating with the device. So that is my point. Did you catch that? I was able to design the program, compile it and run it without having to SSH binaries to the embedded device or like waiting for some serial garbage connection to be established. But let's keep going here. Now we'll go ahead and we'll detect when we move the joysticks up and down so that we can use it to control the motors. Let's do that. Okay, so it looks like we can use next event to intercept every time we move the joystick and every time we push a button. Let me just close the terminal so that you have some more space there. So event, I want event to be... Okay, just to recap, we want to use the left stick to control the DC motor and the right stick to control the servo. So let's see what axis gives us. Okay, so let's process the events when axis is of type A. Right, can we do this? Is this legal? No? Why not? Do go ahead and import it. Interesting. Okay, so this is pretty cool because that match statement will catch all the left stick X events. Let's do one for, well, we care about the Y events, not the X events. So left stick Y, and we care about stick X. That's what we want. And then we want the value and the code. We might or might not need it. For now, I want to print the values just to get a sense of what we get in there. Let's see. Oh, Jesus. Okay, so the program terminates immediately. So what we need is a loop that like covers this while loop. Now it should work. What's the problem? Whatever, let's run it. Nice, that's more like it. Check it out. If I move the stick, in this case, we said that we care when we move this up and down, then it changes in real time pretty much. And it ignores the changes in X. And with the right stick, it should care when we move it left and right, but it should ignore the changes like up and down, which is fantastic. We're in business, let's go. So let's step back and let me paint a picture of how everything is hooked together. So the core of our system is the Raspberry Pi. In my case, I'm using a Raspberry Pi 4, which are right now like 50 bucks or something, because don't look at the search history. That's my wife, I swear to God. So it's $60, $100 if you want all the connection kit and all that, which I do recommend. This is not a sponsored video. I just think it's great stuff. To control the DC motor, we need an edge gate. an H-bridge. I have another video where I detail how the H-bridge and the DC motors work together, so go ahead and check that out after we have the DC motor. And then we have the Xbox controller via USB cable. And finally, we have our servo. So it's important to mention that both the DC motor and the servo are controlled via an external power supply. To control the H-bridge, as I detailed on that other video, you need two GPIO pins, GPIO 1 and GPIO 2. And then for the motor, for the servo, you just need one GPIO. So these are just names. This is not the actual number of the GPIO. So this GPIO controls the servo. These two are used to control the H-bridge. Jesus, this diagram is horrible, but it paints a picture of what we are trying to build here. So this is the RC card that I cannibalized the motors from. The idea is that after I'm done with this project, I'll be able to remote control it without having to 3D print a chassis and all the stuff that an RC car actually entails. Guys, I'm so happy. I was able to take both the servo and the DC motor from the RC car. And let me break down for you how the servo works. There are three wires that you use to control this thing. The red and the brown cables are used for powering the device. And the yellow cable is used to send a PWM signal. And basically, based on the duty cycle of your PWM, you control the angle of the servo, which is pretty awesome. Regarding the DC motor, I have a whole video about it, so feel free to check it out after this video. To find the frequency and duty cycle that I need to use to control the servo, I use an oscilloscope along with the original circuit of the RC car. Fantastic. Now I want to do a quick exercise with you. We are going to create a program that allows us to make the servo rotate from this position to this position in 10 seconds, and then it will reset, and then it will do the same thing over. The intent of this is to validate the parameters that we found for our servo. So I defined this as constants up here, and let's just jump right into it. I'll break it down for you, but what I expect from you is to follow through it, and you know, let's learn together here. So first we'll connect the chip in Linux, at least on Ubuntu. This is what you get. And then you need to get the line that you want to use. So line 6 in our case. And then we need to configure it as an output. Line request. Yeah, that sounds about right. I think this name here doesn't matter. This is for your own bookkeeping, basically. This is a name you give to Linux to use. And then we are going to need a couple of loops. Right, so we have two loops, because on one of the loops we are going to iterate and change the position, and on the outer loop we are going to reset the whole animation, I wanted to call it, or the whole motion. So we know that we need two loops for that. A loop of loops, and then we are going to take the start time. Let's use instant for that. And here's where it really gets interesting. Obviously, AI kind of figures out what I'm trying to do here, and it's mostly right, but it will be lazy just to take that. What we are going to do is, let's do some math together. So we are going to compute the time that the pulse needs to be on and the time that it needs to be off. To do that, well, let's declare those two variables, time on microseconds, and this is going to be a float 64, and it's going to be equal to the pulse mean plus some delta that we are going to calculate. Time on micros increment, right? And then the time off in microseconds will equal to the period in microseconds minus the time that the servo was on, or the PWM was on. So that's good. I'm just going to create a placeholder for this. Time on microseconds increment. So I'll just make it 0 to start with. We'll just add all the logic and then I'll come back and work out the math. Then we want to print the values just for sanity check. So time on, let's just do it. Time on is this, and time off. Time off microseconds is this other value here. So hopefully you see how I am like creating the structure of our program. And then what are we going to use to generate this square signal? We are going to just use a couple of sleep messages. So we set the value to on, then we wait for time on microseconds, and then we flip the beat to off or 0, and then we wait once again. Wonderful. So we have a structure here. We have the structure, but let's compute the time that we need to stay on. That's where we need to do a tiny bit of math. So we said that we'll have a cycle of 10 seconds. Where did we define that? Out here. So I guess the rule that we'll create first is the reset rule. So if elapsed time is larger than 10 seconds, then break, and that will make our loop like reset. And last thing you need to do is to compute how much time do we need to add to the initial time. To do that, we compute the delta. Delta is constant. We can put it out here so that it's not computed over and over. So pulse delta is going to be the maximum versus the minimum microseconds. There you go. So what we need to add here is a proportion. So basically, if we are going to break down, if we are going to animate for 10 seconds, animate. If our loop, if our iteration will take 10 seconds, then we are going to make the angle proportional to how long has this loop been running. And we'll say elapsed time divided by cycle duration. There you go. So yeah, I figured it out. So this is how we get, let's see if we get that smooth motion here.
I decided to use my iPad to debug the program. And here we see how the servo is swinging back and forth. I changed the period to 5 seconds. And check this out. When elapsed time reaches 5, it resets back to 0, which is pretty sweet. Now let's put everything together.
So check this out. I think I came with a very clever way to present the one program that runs both the DC motor and the servo to highlight the bigger architectural concepts as opposed to like every nitty-gritty, every line of code. Let me know what you think. So check this out. The program uses two channels, one to send to dispatch events to the servo and another one to dispatch events to the motor. So I'm using message passing as opposed to an arc mutex and all that garbage that I don't want to deal with. We create one thread for the servo, one thread for the motor. We send the receiving ends of the channels to each of these threads. And then we create a run loop to pull events from the controller. This should be extremely familiar. And here's how I am relaying the events using the sender to each of the respective channels. Okay, this is one of the unique moments in my history where you'll see me writing comments. So, to control the servo, we already went through the code, so I'm not going to bore you with that. What I want you to focus on is how am I scaling the stick X coordinate to control the angle of the servo. Here's what I do it. The value of the stick goes from -1 to 1. So we need to scale it to the pulse range and add the minimum pulse width. And that's how we achieve the control of the servo. So let's test with these boundary values. When value equals to -1, this whole thing becomes 0. So pulse min microseconds plus 0 equals to pulse min microseconds. And when value equals 1, then this whole thing becomes pulse range. And pulse range will... pulse range equals to pulse max minus pulse mean. And because of that, we'll end up with pulse mean microseconds plus pulse range almost. That's almost pulse max in microseconds. And that's how we get that full range of values. Okay, I just had kind of a huge breakthrough because I just made a change to the code that helps to or prevents damage to the battery and to the DC motor. So let me show you what I'm talking about. So within the motor control thread, I added a very simple controller that will gradually change the target duty cycle. So let's say that you suddenly change the stick position. Instead of just changing the velocity and direction of the motor like instantaneously, I added this controller that will change that duty cycle in increments of 10 units. And the results are amazing.
Let me show you exactly what I'm talking about. So I commented out the controller. So now it's just literally whatever the target duty cycle is, we assign that immediately to the current duty cycle. And so if I just change the velocity gradually, everything works as expected. But if I change it suddenly, that causes an overload on my power supply. So that's not great. Let's add the control back and see if it helps. All right, so we added the control back. Now let's go reset our power supply and see if it stops complaining. Boom, okay, so it's reset. Now let's focus on this bad boy over here. There you go. And now let's do the same exact test. And I cannot make the DC power supply trip anymore. Doesn't matter what I do. I want to break it. Ah! So this makes our system a lot more stable. And a lot more realistic. Yes.